stuff, and sometimes they came to me and told me about something that their SEO agency told them, that the links have to be different, or there should be better content, or the URL should be named completely different, or should be Chinese, or something like that. So there was a lot of stuff which was not really doable. Also, the customer was not able to actually do the content-related stuff, because the SEO agency said, hey, please rewrite all your content. But the customer has 5,000 pages and 50 editors, so it's not like something you can quickly do, especially if the text has to be verified, for example, by technical persons or scientists. And then there was this technical part, like fixing the site, or fixing like some, yeah, the title was not displayed, or when you share a page, it looked quirky, or something like that. So last year, when I became product owner, some of our customers approached me and told me, hey, we had those SEO agencies, they only deliver us those reports. The report says a lot of stuff is bad, but they cannot do anything about it, because we cannot quickly change the content, and the people who can actually fix the technical stuff is us. So the SEO agency is not really able to do that much in this case, in those projects. So they asked me, hey, can you not do all that? And I said, wasn't so happy about it. But at the end, we said, OK, let's try it. We look into it. We use some SEO monitoring tool. And now most of my Monday mornings is getting a coffee and reading through 6 SEO reports from different projects and seeing what's going on there. It crawls, the tool crawls the websites every week. And then I look into it and see if there's something wrong. And then I go to the customer and tell them, hey, here we can improve something. Here you improve something. Next week we can see if it's getting better or not. And so I'm and my team is also slowly learning about what we can do there. And there are good parts. There are interesting parts, especially from the view of a developer who wants to have something testable, something which can be, which is clear why it's not working or not. And not like, yeah, you have to rename, like you just said, your CSS classes so it performs better in Google, because nobody can really verify that. And every time Google does a big update, those people also say, hey, you have to change everything else again. So we focus on the stuff that we can verify, that we can test, and which at the end we realized lead us to write better code. So a lot of the optimizations we did, a lot of the stuff that we fixed that the tools reported to us, led to that we fixed a lot of errors in the website that nobody ever saw. Or we improved the performance in a lot of places that we missed, or we added a lot of new information to the website which different search engines like Google and Bing and so on could read. And what I like about it in those 6 months or 7 months that we did that in a few projects, those projects got a lot better because of that. And when we implement features, we think more about that, think more about the semantic and what we are actually doing and how it would look to a search engine. Also, our features are getting better. So that made me more excited about this whole topic and not just adding a title and some keywords. Yeah. So first, the SEO package. What it does for you. You can find it in the Neo's package repository, install it via Composer. And what it does, it provides mix-ins for adding some basic metadata to any Neo's website. Simple metadata like the title, description, keywords, and so on. The open graph data that you can enter, title, description, open graph type, and the image, which is used, for example, by Facebook, and I also think LinkedIn. Twitter cards for Twitter, and canonical links to not have duplicate content. And also XML sitemap. You also get not only the mix-ins to build a sitemap, you get a configurable sitemap, and it makes sense to configure it because Usually, the default might render some pages into the sitemap that you don't want there. Maybe you get external links or some shortcuts or some pages that shouldn't be there, which also you will see in the reports when the tool or the search engine is complaining that this is not something useful. But it's really easy to adapt it because it's written in Fusion and Fluid, so you can change it to your needs. It adds the metadata to all page types. And you can edit it here in the inspector. So the editor just selects a page, goes to the tab in Neos, and enters all this information. It's a good boilerplate for doing SEO in Neos. Even if it's in the base package not enough for you, it's still a good starting point. I use it all the time, and it's really working well. And you should extend it, and you should override it. What I mean with that is that if you have the description here, or the titles and images, if you have the chance that if you have a node type, a page type, which already contains the information that you would put anywhere there, and the editor would actually only copy it from the node, just hide those fields, and in the node type configuration, or in Fusion, read it from this other property. Then the editor only maybe has a few fields here and not this whole list, and has to scroll and fill that all out. Because then it's more easy to miss. If, for example, a blog post usually has a teaser, so use this teaser text maybe here and crop it. It makes it much easier. You can also provide fallbacks. That's also not included by default for most fields. So you can just say, for example, the open graph type, if it's not set, then just usually it's a website. There are a few other packages you can use. For example, here is something to include the Google Tag Manager. Then from T3, there's also plugin SEO, which adds some fields, and SEO Helper. You can, from time to time, look into the package repository on Neos.io and maybe find something there. Tracking. There are two packages for Google and Pivik. I think that's the most used tracking tools. They perform more or less the same thing. You see live data in the Neos backend, also in the inspector here. So the editor selects a page, sees, oh, there are a lot of hits, and doesn't need to go to the Google Analytics or Pivik backend, has live data, doesn't have to filter anything, and gets the information there. This helps a lot, I think, for editing, because you see live data there and can decide, is your content actually good or bad? And for example, if two editors fight that because there's a lot of pages and a lot of content and you want to clean the site up, and the editor says, oh, my site is so important, you just can look there and then see if it's that important. Or maybe if it performs really well and you actually wanted to rewrite the page or redo it, maybe you should not do it and instead create a new page. I think this removing the step between looking at the tracking and working in the website is really helping there. It automatically adds the tracking scripts. Of course, you have to provide the tracking ID from Google, but in the configuration. Both packages have a backend module to set up the initial configuration, but that's not working in all cases so well, because at the end, you still need to have the configuration in your in the settings YAML that you deploy, because if you do it on the live system, it might be overwritten by a deployment and so on. So you have to be a bit careful there with the configuration. It depends on your setup. The Google package, tracking package, is maintained by the core in the Neos namespace on Google, GitHub. And the Pivik package is maintained by the community. It got the Neos 3.0 release some days ago. And there's also some parts missing of those in those packages. For multi-sites, it's a bit harder to configure them, because you might want to have different accounts for each domain, and that's currently not possible to configure, or not easy. So this is something that needs to be improved in the future. If you still want to use the backend module, the configuration should be persisted somewhere. It could be instead of written to the settings YAML, it could be written to some persistent cache, for example. And something my customers always want, because they sometimes have different, the systems where the editors work are not necessarily the production systems. So the problem with both packages is that not all the data is actually arriving in the staging system, because it submits its own URL, its own domain, and then uses that for filtering in analytics or PWIC, what hits are shown, what data is shown. And the staging system, of course, has a different URL and is a different system, so not all the data is arriving there. So we need some configuration there to simulate, hey, where it's like production, but it's not actually production. And even in development, I sometimes would like to see the actual data there. OK, advanced mobile pages. Who knows about that? What it is. OK, that's good. It's about building the future web together. It's beautiful. Also, sometime like half a year ago, I think it popped out up for me first time, and also a colleague told me about it, and I read what it is, and that Google is doing it, and nobody else is doing it, and I thought, okay, that doesn't matter at all. But then, after a while, I realized that when I Google on my phone, I see special results, and they say AMP, and when I click on them, it just immediately loads the article, no matter where I am. It's super fast, and it's really nice to use. And I read, oh, more people are now supporting it, and I read a bit through what the technical stuff behind it actually is. Because it sounded for me similar like the Facebook instant articles, which also got a lot of bad press. Google seems to do a bit of a better job, but still, they are still the main ones who support it. I think Bing and the search engines in other countries still don't do much with it. But the concept behind it, I think, is still valuable for pages in general, because what Google is doing, here you see a search result here. Lightning means better, good. If you click it, you just get the page pre-rendered, delivered by Google, and the web server is not actually doing anything. It's basically a guideline for HTML, JavaScript, and CSS. It means it validates that how you build your page is good. Like, it forces you to leave out stuff, bad stuff, like 10 tracking scripts, or big bloated images, or bad structure, or errors in the code, and including 50 JavaScripts and 50 CSS files. So it forces you to behave nicely. That's what we actually anyway want to do, but Google now felt the need to force us to do it, apparently. The good thing is it allows validation, so if you don't behave correctly or your website doesn't behave right, it will not appear in the Google search results like that. The goal is to increase performance, instant articles behavior. It forces you to make less cluttered sites. For example, you have to have only one place in the code where you have to add all the CSS without an include to an external file. So, and the JavaScript also has to be at a specific position. A lot of tags have to be special. Some tags are not even allowed. It automatically runs optimizations. So, for example, you deliver the original high-quality images to Google, and Google will then, when it prepares the AMP versions of the website, in a way that is optimal for the client. It is cached by Google if you want. There are exceptions. Automatically, it's cached by Google. If you don't want that, for example, if you use forms or something like that, then it will not happen, of course. And you get a special bonus here in the search results. And I think it works quite well, because if a Google search result looks different than other search results, a lot of more people are clicking it. So what's special about it? It provides special components and tags. For example, instead that you include your React or jQuery component to have a carousel or some lightbox or something like that, those components are provided by the AMP library. There's a library on a website where you can go through and look what is available, what cool tools you can use there, like also everything can be used for swiping. It's optimized for all kinds of devices. Everything is responsive. They add new functionality quite often. Until recently, a lot of newspapers and online news pages didn't want to use it because there was no way to do tracking, which was good for us, but yeah, not for them. Also, they don't like that they cannot show you beautiful full screen pop-ups with please click to subscribe or something like that, and you have to find a little X in the corner. And now they added a bit of that functionality, like the minimum what those people need to do tracking and other stuff. I think advertisements are now also possible. Interactive elements, like I said, sliding, carousels, pop-ups and other features, nice effects, special animations which use the hardware acceleration of the different mobile devices. And if you want to read more, there's on this AMP project site, there's a lot of documentation, really good documentation, also an easy introduction how to use them, and yeah, also validation for everything. There's also a special page for platform support where you can read who uses it, who supports it, and yeah, who's behind the whole project. Some months ago, I built this into my blog package, which is also on GitHub for NEOS. And when you click the search result that you saw in the previous screen, you get this page like that. It's maybe not perfectly beautiful yet, but I just wanted it to work. And you get this bit of a special view. Like here you get this header, which is provided by AMP, which allows you to close the search result and immediately go back to Google. It allows you here to link it, because if you want to share the page that you're on, this page is delivered by Google. And if you share that, then it would be maybe some kind of crazy URL, which is not helpful and which doesn't lead to your actual page. So they now have this additional button, which you should press to share this page with your friends. And some additional options also. So check out the package. It uses rendering switch for AMP. That means if you go with the desktop browser to the page, you will see the old normal page. There's nothing special, but it will contain in the header a small link for Google, which tells Google there's also another version for that. And if Google accesses this version, it gets a differently rendered page. It injects the CSS and the JavaScript that you need for that to work. It replaces special tags for the blog. I replace all the images have to be replaced with for a different tag name, and also have additional options. So this is something that has to be customized for different projects. In this blog package, I of course don't know what you use in your project. I know that there are maybe images, but for some other components, this has to be extended. Yeah, the alternative URLs for discovery by Google. And get inspired and copy it and play around with it. And I also saw that some other people on Twitter are already working with AMP and doing some things. And maybe at some point there's a package which makes the whole thing a bit easier. I will come to that in the next slides. So here is, for example, how I make a blog post with its image compatible, because the normal image tag is not allowed. AMP looks for the AMP image tag. And so I do the easy thing and replace all image tags with the AMP image, and also add the property layout responsive so they are automatically responsive when you look at it on the phone. Other way of doing it, you don't have to build AMP in the whole page. Not every page has to have that. Usually it makes a lot of sense for news pages, because they are also usually in Google quite at the top, and those are interesting to be accessed very fast. So in my blog example, I also only did it for the blog posts and nothing else. You can use a few of those specials. I only use the special image tag, but you can use whatever you want. There's also, some days ago, by Daniel Kestler was a blog post, which is interesting, where he showed how to override individual templates of individual prototypes in EOS to have an alternative rendering which works better with AMP. Some notes which are on that, the whole topic. What I realized for myself when using it, the way it's not so much about the technical part, but how it's actually presented. During this whole Trump thing, the election and so on, I often Googled for articles and wanted to read something. And Google builds carousels often out of those articles. And in this case, it's both USA Today. I couldn't find a better screenshot. But often when I Googled for an article, it showed me this carousel, and I could swipe through like 10 articles to the same topic by different news companies. So that was really good to get an overview of what's actually going on. So I could click into them very fast and then go to the next one. You can also, when you're in the article, I think with swipe, go to the next article. So you can quickly read through different opinions to the same topic. And that's something I liked about this whole thing. I mean, that's not necessary. That's for that, AMP is not really needed, but it's an effect that I liked about it. Yeah, you can compare the sources. It's really good for areas with slow internet. The JavaScript that is loaded is not so big. It's still 200 kilobytes, but everything else is optimized, so the pages are really, really fast, and the JavaScript can be cached on the client, so it behaves really good. And as far as I know, the Facebook instant articles are quite bloated at some point. Yeah, in developing countries, this is really good. People can read more easily. The bad thing is, it's mainly supported by Google, and we have to see what happens there. So, rich snippets and cards. It's also a bit related to AMP, but not the same thing. So, this is basic HTML. It shows something. It's apparently about a theater event. It has some date and some time and so on, but there's like no semantic there. We, as a person, know what it is, but any machine would be a bit confused what it actually means, maybe. And then we can add rich data, and then it looks like this. And now it's perfectly fine, easy to understand. This now contains all the information that a machine or anyone might ever want to know about this theater thing. You know where to buy the ticket, you know the Wikipedia article, you know who invented or came up with the story. Everything is in there. So this is one way of adding rich data to your content to make it more accessible by machines. I don't like this style. I think it's very hard to do, and it also needs a lot of the editor or the developer who makes the template has to be very careful what to do there. And also, if your project goes on and you further develop it, you have to be really careful to put all your markers or placeholders and everything at the right place and render it correctly. There's another way of doing it. Like, there are three ways of, it's about schema.org data, actually. There are three ways of rendering them. The first two ways look like this, more or less. And the third way, the one I like, is JSON data. It's called JSON-LD, which is for linked data. And you add it somewhere on the page. It doesn't need to be exactly where the other HTML is. It just needs to be in the page somewhere. And it tells the machine also what is existing on the page. And you use the schema data on schema.org. You look what you need. You have here the theater type, the name, and everything is structured and more easily readable and can be is more accessible by also by any kind of code. So what does it actually do? If we add this data to events, here of one of our customers. We added it recently to their event list, and now on Google, when you search for their events, you get additional listings here. For example, Google just immediately shows some of their events because it knows there are events and knows what to do with it. They know where it is, they know when they are, and link them. Our customer was very happy about that, so that was nice. Yeah. Rich cards can be are the next level. Those are they really get their own visual representation. For example, if you look for movies, a theater, you get those cards here, which are really nice. If you look for a chocolate cake, you get this information on the right. If you look for great artists, you also get this information. And Google has this also this gallery where you can see what kinds of types Google is indexing, and also gives the special rendering. And if you read SEO articles, they always talk about search result number zero, because there are always the 10 search results, but this information always gets its premium position. So if you get there, if you get something in there, it's really valuable because it automatically catches the eye, like here and here. So Google provides different types of visualization. Currently, it's recipes, events, products, and reviews. Each of them get their own visual representation in the Google search results. Other information is sometimes only shown in the normal search results, like also breadcrumbs and so on. Other information is not indexed currently, but maybe at some point. In this Google search gallery, you can find the explanation how to do it and also how to validate if you want to build something like that. How to use it. Dominique already had a good example of the aquarium yesterday. So you go to schema.org, look for the thing that you want to show, to give the information to Google and others, and look for it, and then you get the structure, and then you can build the whole thing. You can add the data via HTML. Maybe that sometimes is not bad. For example, if you just want to add a bit of information to images over the whole page. In most cases, I think JSON-LD is a bit of a better way to do it, because you can add the information somewhere. It's not related to the visual representation, to the markup. Yeah, you should split the presentation from data, in my point of view. Makes it much more stable when you change something. Google has a testing tool for all the structured data, so you can just tell it, go to this website, show me all the data, show me warnings, show me errors. Sometimes we found out that, for example, in this event list that I showed, the customer has like 1,000 events, and two of them had some problem. So we looked into that and found out that the customer forgot to set a link there. So we told them, and they fixed it. It was also quite good. The Google Webmaster Tools provide you also with automatic analytics of what's going on your site. On my blog, I have 12 websites. I have 12 people, which are always, that's only me, but it's appearing 12 times. Breadcrumb list. The breadcrumb list is also good for search results because it shows a little breadcrumb before you go to the page, so you can the user can already access or see the structure of where the content is, and 6 news articles. There are no errors, that's also quite good, and yeah, you can monitor what's going on there. In our customer projects, we have like thousands of elements here, and you can also check through all of that. One thing that was also very attractive for us to render JSON-LD data was we can use it as a data source, not only for the search engine, which might do something with it, but we don't even know exactly what it does, but we can also use it ourselves. And for this, the customer has those lists of downloads. Previously, we rendered them when you went there, and it was a very slow process, and it took a lot of PHP and stuff. And at some point, we said, OK, we have to optimize the whole thing. And we knew, oh, we actually anyway want to give more information to Google. So we first rendered all the data that we have over of all our assets, or the assets that the customer wants to render on this page, with the schema.org data. So we deployed this already. Then we could verify it and test it. And Google also said, yeah, it can index it, and it's fine, and looks good. And then we started to build our new React listing, and with JavaScript we can just, because it's JSON, we can just read the data and feed it into our React component and have this listing here with a live search with pagination, and this way We have this super fast, in this case it's called literature room download list, which we can cache, which we can deliver with Varnish. We don't have to do anything in PHP anymore when the user serves it, so that's really cool. And the JSON data can also be compressed with gzip very well. That means the site is, even with 6,000 documents, we tested it, and it was very, very little, and the page was still so much faster than before when we rendered the whole thing with Fluid and so on. And we want to extend this system also to the news pages, to the events pages, and other pages where we anyway now have all this data lying around, and we can just use it. So adding microdata is in Fusion quite simple. I created this prototype for microdata, and I add it to the head. That's really nice in Neos. You can add anything anywhere, much better than in other system where you have to somehow get into the header and remove maybe the previous description or data and then add it in the right place and so on. So this is really nice. And you can check, you only add it if it's a blog entry in this case. You can also do it another way. You can do a processor to a certain node type and just say, after this node type is rendered, also render any kind of metadata that we have. And this is how this microdata looks. My first try was to implement it only with Fusion. It needs a lot of code, but I think it's still good. Maybe we can find some better place, way to simplify it a bit. But basically, you use the tags. You need to set, it's basically a script tag of type application JSON. It uses, and then you can have raw arrays where you define all the data. Here, the context, schema.org. Here you have to be careful to use the hyphens because the at symbol is used by Neos for Fusion. And the type, and then you can add all the information that you want. And at the end, I added a processor who does the JSON serialization. Yeah. And if you abstract that and create maybe some mix-ins or helpers, it should be really easy to add microdata to all kinds of node types. Okay, so my concept for SEO editing mode. This idea came because the customers started showing me around before Christmas, was it? There's this SEO plugin for WordPress called Yoast, and several customers called me and, hey, we want the same in Typo3 and Neos, and please make that possible somehow. So I looked into that and. I had to say the plugin is really nice in WordPress. What it does, while you type, it shows you how well you do your SEO thing from an editorial perspective. Like, do your keywords appear in the content or not? Is your content too long, too short? Is something missing? So if the editor writes his article, and at the end he gets this little traffic light system where he sees red, green, red, yellow, and if everything is green, he can shut off his brain and knows everything is right. So here's this little prototype I built. I actually wanted to do much more, but then the time was also short again. And I played around with adding an alternative SEO view to Neos, which just, instead of showing it in Inspector, which is a bit hard to get actually an overview of what you're doing, to show you in a special mode. So here you can I have made a little blocks here, which show the data that you entered into the inspector or in other ways. The next step would be make this all inline editable. Then you don't even need to have this stuff in the inspector anymore. And for example, here the meta description is rendered. Then automatically it splits the list of keywords and goes through all the titles and text properties that you have in the page and looks how often those keywords appear. Because that's also something the customers asked me for, that this is like super important to them, because you shouldn't have a keyword which never appears in the content. So for example, I just said, okay, if a keyword doesn't appear at all, it's red, it's bad, If it appears only like up until 5 times, it's average. This is not actual numbers of how you should do it. I just wanted to test it. I think it's around 3 times is good. And if it appears a lot of times, then it's green. So this is good. And this, to create this listing, it's only a bit of Fusion and a flow query helper, which counts all the occurrences. Also a listing of the open graph data that you entered, and a bit of content statistics. I used a small library for that, which counts the characters, counts the words, and there's also like some SEO articles also say you should have a certain amount of words or you get some kind of warnings. And here I just said if it's like 150 words, then it should be fine. Also the average words per sentence, and I added a small function, which I think has to be is very depending on the language, but for German I set it, and it divides the number of characters by 220, or the words by 220, and then has this rough time of how long the article needs to be read, or how the average person needs to read it, and then you also see if the articles may be too long to read. And here you could do a ton of things, but I realized also while looking at the new React UI, it might be much easier soon. If we can use React components and actually have this data, maybe not in a separate view, but somehow also get a live view while the editor is working in the inspector or in some other way which does updating live, so you don't have to switch the view, because this means that the editor might just forget about it. But having it on the right or the left, or some pop-up, or some button, extra button where here it shows red or yellow or green, what the current status is on average, and the editor knows immediately that he has to do something. It highlights the good and the bad parts. You can add any kind of other information that you want here. Maybe also retrieve external data, or maybe use the package to do some statistics on how easy the text is to read, and also show this information. Other ideas are to show a Google preview, how Google would render the result. This is a bit harder because now Google has so many ways of rendering stuff, so this might be a bit more difficult to get it right. Or preview already the Twitter cards. I think some projects already have something like that, but this could also be a nice addition to this SEO view package. But there are all kinds of different ways how search results and so on can look nowadays, so as I said, it might be a bit harder. Some more ideas are, like as I said, the React UI with live updates, use different components to show this information. Use Elasticsearch to do a better text analysis, because I did the simple thing, I just concatenated all the text and searched through the occurrences. But I read a bit about that Elasticsearch is also able to extract keywords from a text, so you could maybe even show that there might be interesting keywords which don't appear in the keyword list yet. So it could go in both ways. Or like you could help the editor to fill out the keyword list instead of him thinking about it. Yeah, and at one point finish and release the package. Maybe it's just a good place to get ideas from or to copy code from. I don't know if it should actually be a complete package, but I think I will still work on it. And when we have more projects where we can use it, it might get a better status and we can release it. You can find the concept here on GitHub in my space. It's called SEO View, the package. You can copy, extend it, install it with Composer, and yeah. So, any questions?
We have time. Just in case. Okay.
Just one small note from my side. A feature of Neos that is mostly liked by any customer is the automatic redirect handler, which which does database entries if you move a page around in the page tree. I think you should mention that feature if you do SEO talks, because that's a real cool feature.
Yeah, that's right. Okay.
It's currently not manageable in the backend by the editor, but I'm working on building a redirect manager, which gives you the ability to see all the redirects with statistics and checks for round trips and so on.
Okay,
so
that's cool.
Yeah. But it's will work in progress.
Yeah. Okay. Any other question in the back?
You know of any Facebook instant pages plugin extension like your?
No, I don't. And we don't have, in the company, don't have the need to do that because our customers don't do anything on Facebook really.
Okay.
And but it should be similar, I guess. If you can do an alternate rendering mode, which fits well for the AMP, I think you can easily also adapt that to Facebook.
Yeah, okay. And another question, why did you choose the string replace route and not just do it in Fusion?
You mean overriding the prototypes?
Yeah.
Because I don't know what prototypes the project has. Because this is the block packages separately.
Okay.
So I could override all images, but I don't know if the user, the integrator would like that. So the passive, careful way is overriding those image tags in a way that the chance to break something is very low. But at a later point, if I support more components there, it might be better to, or if I write documentation, say those prototypes are supported, for the rest you have to do something yourself, this is another way.
Okay.
I have a more less technical question. I hear many SEO people arguing that using keywords is bad. You're using those keywords. You're actually setting the metadata keyword.
Yeah. Some are saying so. Some are saying, or a lot of people are saying you should add them to the site, but they are not used. Yeah. So, for example, those people who do the Yoast plugin for WordPress, they have a really good blog, also a technical blog where they explain a lot of stuff and really try to make sense of what's going on. And they also say something like that. You should add keywords, but they are not used. So I don't know what to do with that. But in this case, I don't think it's a problem because if you define the keywords, if you, as an editor, say, I want to write something about NEOS, about CMS, and about JavaScript, and one of those keywords is not appearing in the content, I can use it just to get my article right. So you can also decide just to throw away the keywords when rendering and not show them, but use it for editing.
And you're right now not yet recognizing word variations, right?
Sorry?
The Yoast plugin recognizes word variations. So similar words meaning the same?
Synonyms.
Yeah.
I don't know if it does it. Is it a question or do you know that?
Does your plugin do that?
No, it doesn't. That's also something that would work with Elasticsearch, for example, because it knows about synonyms, it also knows about stop words, and could make a much better text analysis than my Flow query helper. Yeah.
No question? Then coffee. Okay. Thank you. We are waiting for feedback too.